Well, welcome back. Did you enjoy dinner? All right, good. Really, those of you in Australia, New Zealand, and in Moscow, we're glad you could join us, but you did miss the mashed potatoes, which were phenomenal, as well as the rest of the meal. Our next speaker has talked in front of thousands of people. However, our next speaker has never been filmed professionally. Our next speaker I met through a cosmic collision that has only happened once in all of galactic history. It happened in September of 1971. I met our next speaker. And as a result, lots of things have happened. You're here as a result. I have 7 grandchildren as a result. Well, the whole world is a better result as this consequential collision that occurred 45 years ago. Our next speaker deserves an introduction. She's written several national best-selling books on her own. She's co-authored 11 national best-selling books that have hit the New York Times best-selling list. She has taught literally millions of people about how to cook. She is the inventor, and I don't exaggerate, she is the inventor of something extremely unique, and that is low-fat vegan cooking. Now, before our next speaker was encouraged by me to help take care of my patients by inventing a completely new way of cooking, and it was completely new. She is the originator of low-fat vegan cooking. Before that invention, there was low-fat, which was skinned chicken and skim milk, and there was vegan drowning in oil. And neither of them caused good health. But because of her talents and because of a need, and the need was to help people to understand and follow something basic, which is the diet for human beings, she stepped up to the plate, delivered. As she's going to deliver for you tonight, I'd like to bring up stage Mary McDougall. And I don't kiss many speakers.
Good thing. Okay, so now wouldn't it be great if you could all bring the chef home with you tonight? And for all of our meals, then nobody would ever have to worry about cooking the food. Because this is what I hear all the time. Oh, I understand all the principles, and I really know what I ought to be doing, but it's so hard. It's really not hard. I'm going to teach you how to make it easy. But that's the excuse I often get. My goal is to make it so easy that and make it so simple that anybody can do it. But I know you'd all like to have your own personal chef, because then everybody could do it. It'd be really easy. So one of the first things you have to consider is, what kind of a cook are you? Now, when I first met John, I was a terrible cook. I mean, he makes it sound like this was really easy, just to tell me I have to cook and invent recipes to give to his patients and everything would be fine, right? I was terrible. I never learned anything from my mother. When I lived by myself, I ate stewed tomatoes out of a can. I didn't know how to make anything. And so when he said to me, you know, you have to invent low-fat vegan recipes so that I can give them to my patients so that they can make the food that I'm telling them they have to eat to get healthy, I was like, oh, Wow. That's a big job. There were a lot of foods at that time that I had no idea what they were. So gradually, you know, I got into it, and we started with simple things, and we got a little more complicated. And as our children grew up, I got even a little more complicated. And I turned myself into what I would never consider myself a chef. I turned myself into a really good home cook that makes, that just happens to make low-fat vegan food that tastes good. And that's my goal for all of you. And I realize that these days we don't have a whole lot of time. All of us are busy working, or we're busy with our children, or we're busy doing projects. And we don't want to, or we don't have the time to spend in the kitchen. Even though we might like to, and maybe sometimes, if we're having a big dinner party, we'll take a couple hours and make something really special. But for most days, most people want to keep this really simple, right? So, if you want to be a gourmet cook, and you want to spend a lot of time in the kitchen, it's easy to do. John was talking about all the recipes and all the books that we've done. These are all the books that we've done separately and together. Over 3,000 recipes here, and more on our website. So if you want to get complicated and you want to be gourmet, feel free. Some of the recipes in here are much simpler than that, but there are some that, you know, you could spend a couple hours putting the recipe together. And the only time I actually ever do that anymore is when I'm having guests over for dinner, or we're having a birthday party and I'm making a big fancy feast. I'm going to show you in just a few minutes how John and I really eat, and which is what you would really want to learn yourself too, so that you can do it really simply. We also have an app that has over 1,025 recipes on it, some more difficult than others. Really easy to use. You find the recipe you want by putting in the name of a food or the name of a recipe. It makes shopping lists for you. So it's a really great app to have if you like to do your shopping and cooking this way. Really simple. We want to make this easily accessible, because if you don't eat the food, you don't get all the benefits that John and all the other speakers are talking about. It doesn't do any good to know all this stuff. You have to eat the food. You know all the t-shirts that we sell, it says, "It's the food"? That's true, folks. It's the food. It doesn't matter how much you know. You have to eat it. And that's when it works. So your goal is to find some simple meals that you really like. John would say 1 to 6. I'd give you a few more, 1 to 20. Simple things that you can eat over and over again that you really like, that you know you can put together in a short period of time. I usually say that also the rule fits in there that you always have everything in your pantry to put these meals together really fast and really quick and without a whole lot of thought, because you don't want to spend all that time in preparation and in getting ready to eat something, and then 2 minutes later it's done. Have you ever had that thought? I just spent 2 hours working on this, and 5 minutes later it's done? Wouldn't you rather have spent that 2 hours doing something else and have just as healthy and delicious a meal that you can put together in 15 or 20 minutes and have everyone enjoy it? So that's your goal. We want to make this really simple. You can have it really simple, just pasta with a healthy tomato sauce on top. Now you have to have enough food, and I want you to go away hungry, so I'm not going to portion the amount you eat. If you want to eat 3 plates of this, it's fine. three plates of pasta, five plates of pasta, go right ahead. But simple is the goal. A simple rice meal. You can vary the ingredients that you put into it. That's all you have to eat. You don't have to have a whole lot of stuff with it. Just a simple meal. Simple bean burritos. And you can eat five or six of them if you want. Simple mashed potatoes like we had tonight. Really, and that's all you have to eat. One of our guest speakers here this weekend is going to talk about eating potatoes for a whole year. That's all he ate for a whole year was potatoes. They're a wonderful food. Absolutely delicious. And that's all you have is just potatoes. How much easier can it get? I'm going to show you some really easy ways to cook them too. Many people think when we talk about this kind of food that we say, well, just go out and buy a whole bunch of green and yellow vegetables and you're all set. When you look at this, it's really beautiful, isn't it? Isn't it gorgeous? What's missing? The starch. 70 to 90% of your meal should be starch, because this is what's going to keep you filled up and keep you going until your next meal, which is going to also be 70 to 90% starch. Now, you can keep your starch the same if you like. You don't have to vary it a lot, or you can change the starch, vary your meal by changing the different starches that you eat. Really simple. And all these things that are shown here are starches. Now, what to do when you get home? Let's just say you get home and you haven't been eating this way and you have a cupboard and pantry full of stuff that you know shouldn't be there. The best thing to do is to get rid of it all, pile it up in boxes, and give it to your local charity, a local soup kitchen. I know you're giving them food that they really shouldn't eat, so you feel bad about it. They're going to eat it anyway. If it makes you feel really bad, then there's this nice green trash bin. Well, that don't work very well. Well, the big trash bin, you can just trash it. Because if you don't get rid of it, what happens is you save something and you think, well, I'll just put it aside. And, you know, the next time I have guests over, I'll feed it to my guests. What happens? Someday you had a really bad day at work, and it just kind of calls your name. Now, it might not be chocolate that gets you. It might be potato chips or nuts or something else. Something that you didn't throw out of your pantry. You want your pantry to look like this when you start out. I don't want to see any of that old stuff in there. I know this is pretty barren, but this is the way you should start out. Now, on one of your handouts, it tells you how to find all the things I'm going to talk about online. All these handouts that I'm talking about tonight are online. I've given you a whole list for a well-stocked pantry. So you can stock this pantry. It's on the white sheet. You don't have a white sheet. No, it's online. You have to go online and get it and print it out and then take it home and take it to the grocery store. And, you know, I'm going to make this a little bit difficult for you. But I have my own. Yes, you're right. But that's just so I can refer it to you. And this is what yours is supposed to look like when you print it out. Okay. So it goes through a well-stocked pantry, a well-stocked refrigerator, talks about different spices and herbs, seasonings, even well-stocked spices, well-stocked snack foods. So your cupboard doesn't have to look like this. In fact, we want it to look really good with healthy things. You also need to have probably some good quality nonstick pots and pans. My favorite ones are made by Scanpan. They're made from ceramic titanium. It doesn't scratch. It is not made from the old way they made Teflon. This is a baked on, fired on finish. And it looks like this. This is a ceramic titanium. You can buy them on Amazon or at probably any good cookware store. But just go to Amazon, put in Scanpan. See right there, Scanpan. I've given them to all my kids. And we use them all the time. So eventually, unfortunately, we use them every day, several times a day. They do wear out after a while. And things start to stick to them, and then you just say, okay, sandbox toy, or you throw it away. And you buy a new one. Because you want to have a good quality nonstick pan. And the only time you really need a nonstick pan is if you're going to cook something in it without any liquid. For example, what I have up here is hash brown potatoes. Frozen hash brown potatoes in a bag just like this. They come out in the pan. They look just like that when you pour them into the pan. Frozen right out of the bag. You pour them into the pan. Flatten them down lightly with your hand. Put them on the burner. There's a burner here. Cover them up with a lid. Notice I bought the kind that has a glass lid so I don't always have to take it off. And you let them sit there while you kind of watch them for about 5 minutes. Don't be tempted. It's about on medium heat, depending on what kind of a stove you have. I use medium. I have a gas stove on my biggest flame. If you have an electric stove, you might need a little higher heat. Just play around with it a little bit. A little work for you, but you'll get it. Once you get it, then you know exactly where to put it the next time. So you let it go for about 5 minutes. Then you take the top off, and you get one of these kind of spatulas. Not too stiff. It's not going to scratch your pan. And you gently lift up around the edges. See all those potatoes in there? And once they lift easily and they have started to brown and they're not sticking at all to the bottom of the pan, then you can take your spatula and just flip them as many times as you like, flattening them down each time, and just flip them and continue to flip and turn them for about 20 to 25 minutes, depending on how many you're making. And they get nice and brown and crispy without anything added to them. Now, if you read the directions on the back of the package, and it'll tell you how to make hash brown potatoes without fat, it tells you to add water. And guess what happens? They turn to mush. It's like mushy potatoes instead of hash brown potatoes. And so you want a good quality nonstick pan. You don't add any liquid to them. You just let them cook and they get nice and brown and crispy without hardly any effort at all. Really easy to do. My next favorite pot is, we'll move this around, a pasta pot. Or what is sometimes called an all-purpose cooker. And I think that's because it does a variety of things. It's two separate sections, and this is not quite as deep as the bottom of this pan. So you can use it to cook pasta by filling it up to the top line with water and adding your pasta and letting it boil, and when it's finished cooking, you just lift this out, gently shake it, and dump it into a bowl. You don't have to walk all the way over to the sink with the pan and all that stuff. You just gently shake it and dump it out. To steam vegetables, it works even better. You just put about this much water in the bottom of this one, leave this one empty, put it inside, add your vegetables, put the lid on, and let them cook until they're steamed, which usually takes between 5 and 8 minutes. And that's it. And then again, all you have to do is lift out this part, and you know what you avoid? You know those awful little steamer baskets that they sell you to steam vegetables that are, they come out like a flower, and they fit in any size pan, and they always collapse whenever you don't want them to? Every single time, you never have that problem with this. This is the way to steam vegetables. And then when you're done with that, look what you have left. A great stainless steel soup pot. So it's a multi-purpose cooker. Well worth the investment. You can buy them again on Amazon or at any good cookware store in many different sizes. So you decide how much. I have probably 3 or 4 of these in my kitchen in all different sizes. But that's really not necessary. Get a good, versatile one that will serve your the size that you're, of the family that you're cooking for, and you'll be fine. I talked a little bit about cooking pasta. This is one pasta I want to mention that a lot of people miss. It's called tinchiata. It's brown rice pasta. Many people complain to me that they don't like the flavor of whole wheat pasta. And so I always tell them, try tinchiata, the brown rice pasta. Tastes almost exactly like the pasta that you're used to. It doesn't fall apart when you cook it. You can use it in any recipe that calls for any kind of pasta. And it tastes great. No one ever knows it's made from brown rice. So look this one up. Pasta Joy Tinchiata. Comes in all different kinds. Something to stock in your pantry that used to be empty. There's our first thing. Another one of my favorite tools, which I used just the other night, is a slow cooker or a crock pot. Now you see this one right here? Nice, and this does not work, does it? Well, you can imagine I am pointing at the center of this nice round rice round slow cooker. It looks like it hasn't been used very often, doesn't it? You know why? Because I don't use it. It has these buttons on the bottom. See, I'm pointing at the bottom there? Where those buttons are? Oh, I'll point over there. This may work over here. Hey, look at that. Magic. It has these programmable buttons, and I don't like them. I want to have one that says high, low, and off. And that's the one that I use all the time, you see? You can't really see it here. This is on medium right here. And this is on high, or this is low. And off is over here. And this is warm over here. Not too difficult. So this is what we had actually for dinner last night. I'll give you the recipe. It was really hard to do. I started in the morning with my empty crock pot. I poured in a container, about a 2-pound bag of white cannellini beans. So you can tell this one gets used a lot. These are white cannellini beans. And I just put the cover on the crock pot, turned it on high, or I added, three times as much water as beans. Can't forget the water. Then I put the cover on, turned it on high, and let it go for about 4 or 5 hours. Then I added my seasoning mixture. This is the best seasoning mixture. It's made by Kirkland, and it's called Organic No Salt Seasoning. It's a mixture of 21 organic herbs and spices all in this one container. And it's made by Kirkland, so it's a Costco brand. But guess what? The Costco in my area doesn't sell it anymore. Where do you think they sell it? Amazon. So I just buy it on Amazon. And so I add some of that to it. And see these things down here? Anybody guess what they are? Dried, dehydrated tomatoes. We grow a lot of tomatoes in our garden in the summer, and John loves to dehydrate tomatoes. I have got, I bet, 10 containers in my pantry. There's some more things for your pantry. Of dehydrated tomatoes in my pantry, and I just rip them up, maybe this many, handful. We're just guessing here, not being too specific. And I dump them in with the beans and the seasonings and give them a few stirs, put the cover back on and let it cook on high for another couple hours. If you're not home, you can do all of those steps in the morning before you leave, because the tomatoes can cook all day and the seasonings can stay in with the beans all day, because there's no salt in the seasonings, and you don't add salt to beans because salt is what makes beans tough. So you, if you're going to use salt, you would never add it at the beginning of cooking time. All right, a little further along, I start my chopped potatoes. I buy little small potatoes in all different colors, purple and red and white, and I chop them all up, put them in my stainless steel pan, cover them with water, and boil them until they're done. Depending on the size, and they're usually bite-sized pieces, it takes about 15 minutes or so. And then I drain those. In the meantime, I've put in at least 2 cups of spinach or kale or chard that I've chopped up, and I add that to my stew. And then when we're ready to serve it, it looks like this. We have potatoes, the stew over the top, and we usually have sriracha on the side. You always see a lot of that. Sriracha is that real hot red sauce, rooster sauce. We like it. And these are some examples of different kinds of beans that you can use. And every time you cook with a different kind of bean, it changes the flavor of the stew a little bit. So it makes it a little bit different. All right, on from the crock pot, go to my next favorite tool, which is the Instant Pot. Everybody has one of those, right? Yeah, they are very, very popular. You can do so many things with an Instant Pot. This one is not the one that's back in the corner because it doesn't get used. This is the one that I use all the time. My favorite buttons, however, are right here. Plus and minus and manual. Because that way I can adjust what I'm cooking and I can add the amount of time that I want it to cook. They also have a button up here for making rice. They have one for multi-grain. There's one for, there's even a slow cooker button. I haven't tried that one yet. I have a slow cooker, so. But mainly I use the plus and minus and the manual. Great, great invention. And this is what I make most in it, because it's so easy. I make mashed potatoes in my Instant Pot by putting about 8 medium-sized either russet or Yukon Gold potatoes in the bottom of my Instant Pot. And I add 2 cups of water, and I put the lid on, and I use the plus, I don't even have to because it's set right to it, 20 minutes. And I turn it on manual and it goes on. And after 20 minutes, I can either let it come down to natural pressure, or I can unsteam it and the pressure will come off that way. And I mash them right in the pot with a potato masher and a little bit of either the water that they cooked in or some soy milk or rice milk or other kind of non-dairy milk. And while those were cooking, I was making some creamy golden gravy like we had for dinner tonight. And sometimes I have greens in the house, sometimes I don't. If not, I'll just have some corn. It's one of John's favorite meals. And it's very satisfying. And it hardly took any time at all to make. Notice we still have the red sauce here. Gotta have the red sauce, that's what the dots are. Spice it up a little bit. But you can have a big bowl of potatoes with gravy and some vegetables, and it's a very satisfying and easy meal. Didn't take you hardly any time to prepare or any time to think about. Well, another one of our favorite meals are these wonderful purple potatoes. Have you found these yet? They're called Stokes. And they're purple all the way through, like this. These are cooked. Isn't that beautiful? And they taste fantastic. And all you have to do to cook them is put them in the oven. You poke them a few times. You can see my poke holes here. And I put them in the oven, on a tray in the oven. And I bake them for about an hour. And then I take them out and slice them down the center, and they look like this, and we serve them with broccolini or some other greens usually, and some, there's that red sauce again, or some other fat-free dressing that you can find, or something that you've made. You can keep it really easy and just use Dr. McDougall's Right Foods. I actually had this for lunch today. You can pour it in a bowl, or you can eat it right out of the container. We will have some for you when you leave here this weekend, so you can take them with you. They are TSA friendly because there's nothing in them. They go through security just fine. Dr. McDougall's Right Foods also makes soups, organic soups in containers. Even easier, you don't have to add water to them. However, they are not TSA friendly because they have liquid in them and they will confiscate them at the airport. So, but they make great simple lunches, very simple meals, or any of these make great toppings for a baked potato. You don't feel like cooking tonight? Fine, just put a baked potato in. One, two, three, however hungry you are. Put some of this on for a topping. This happens to be split pea. This one is topped with black beans. Different each time, you know. Or hot sauce on potatoes. Or mustard. Mustard in baked potatoes is really delicious. If you've never tried it and you think that sounds really strange, give it a try because it really adds flavor to the potatoes. It's just sort of like the mustard just blends in with the potato and it's really delicious. So very, very simple. You don't even have to cook your own rice anymore. You can buy frozen rice or frozen grains in packages at the supermarket or even at Costco and then just microwave them until they're done. So there's no excuse. When I first got married, I didn't know how to cook rice. My mother never taught me how to cook. We never ate rice, so my mother never taught me how to cook rice. But there were rice cookers wherever we went because we moved to Hawaii. So every store we went into had a rice cooker. So I bought a rice cooker and I learned how to cook rice. Well, I still have my rice cooker. No, I don't have the same one. I have several varieties later of rice cookers, but I don't use it anymore because now, I'm telling you, I keep things simple. I have these things in my freezer. So the only time I use my rice cooker now is if the whole family is coming over and I'm making, you know, 8 or 10 cups of rice for some dish, and then I'll get my rice cooker out and I'll use it for that. Although maybe now that I haven't tried my Instant Pot for rice, I'll have to try that next time when I have to make a large amount of rice, and it'll be even easier. Even vegetables. You don't have time. You say, oh, it's too much work to clean the vegetables. I don't have all that time. Look at all the varieties of frozen vegetables there are. And sometimes these have more nutrients in them than the ones that you get at the supermarket that are supposedly fresh, because these are flash frozen right when they're picked. So they have all the goodness right in them, whereas the ones that are in the market maybe took them 3 days to get there. So don't feel bad using frozen vegetables. They're just as good for you. And there's a lot of variety here too. Just think of all this variety you could add to your baked potatoes. And keep it really simple. Or add it to a rice dish. Now, how about this for simplicity? These are called culinary refried beans. All they are is pinto beans that have been, they're whole pinto beans that have not been cooked. They're smashed, cut into pieces. There's no oil added to them. I don't know if you can read that. There's no oil, there's no salt. So there's nothing, they're just pinto beans. And you mix them with water until they make like a refried bean consistency. And it takes 5 minutes. So you can have burritos in 5 minutes. How simple is that? And of course, where can you buy these?
Amazon.
Make sure you look for the ones that say culinary refried beans, though, because they also sell regular refried beans that have oil in them. So when you're looking for it, this is the color of the package that you want, and this is the kind that you want. You could just have a vegetable sandwich. We had vegetable sandwiches at our home for lunch today with a variety of, let's see, we had avocados and tomatoes and lettuce, and we had some hummus to put on them, and onions. And so you can have a simple meal, really fast, with only a few ingredients. You just have to look for good, healthy bread. And you notice this bread is made without any added oils or, let's see, what else doesn't have in it? Dairy. And it's the local bakery. So what you're looking for, what you need really in a good bread is flour, water, yeast, and a little bit of salt. And that's all you need to make bread. So anything else that's added to it is really unnecessary for the bread. It might be there for the flavor or for something else. But all you need is just water, flour, yeast, and salt to make bread. You don't need oil. You don't need any sugar. You don't need anything else. It works just fine without that. And believe me, I know, because I used to make our own bread when we lived on the Big Island, and there weren't any bakeries around or any stores around that sold healthy bread, because we lived out in the middle of nowhere. So I had to learn how to make all my own stuff. People often ask me, well, what about peanut butter? Because I don't want to give up my peanut butter. Well, companies have taken that into consideration. And there are products like this one right here, PB2. This is a powdered peanut butter that has had 85% of the fat removed out of it. So what you do is you take the powder, you mix it with water until it becomes the consistency of peanut butter again, and you make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. And it has so much less fat than regular peanut butter that we feel it's an okay for an occasional treat. And also to make some of the peanut sauce recipes that are in some of my books, use the peanut, the low-fat peanut butter to make your peanut butter first before you start making the sauce, and you have a sauce that's much lower in fat. And of course, this can be bought at Whole Foods or at Amazon. Amazon carries just about everything. Now, there's a couple of ways. Now, it's much easier if everybody in the family is going to eat the same way, obviously. Because then you can stuff your pantry with all healthy things, and you're all going to be eating the same way. But if that's not how it is in your home, then I have a couple of suggestions. What you do is you make dishes that are things that you put together. This happens to be one. This is a burrito meal where everybody makes their own burrito and they put on it what they like. So everybody in the family can have what they like on their food. You can do this with a pasta dish, where you can make pasta and a really healthy marinara sauce, and then you can have meatballs or something else on the side for those of you that aren't going to eat the same way. With rice dishes, you can do the same thing, where you can have a really healthy base for a rice dish and then maybe have a chicken breast on the top or something that the other members of the family think they will just die if they don't have. You're doing two things in this way, and you're not cooking two whole meals where you're making one thing for you and the rest for somebody else. You're making one basic meal and then you're making things for the other people to add to it. And you're also getting the rest of the family members used to eating healthier bases like the pasta and the marinara sauce or the rice dish that goes under the chicken. See, I can't even say it. Couldn't even remember what that little thing was I was trying to point out. So this happens to be a bean burrito meal. These are the beans that were cooked from scratch, although these days I very often make the instant ones because they're really delicious. Different types of tortillas for all different tastes, corn, wheat, and then there's the low-fat white ones. Remember, we're trying to serve everybody here. There is some lettuce, some tomatoes, some onions, and these are a couple of different kinds of salsas. Here's some rice, brown rice, to put on it. So everybody can kind of choose and make their own burrito. If my grandkids are coming over, I will make some guacamole because they won't eat their burritos without guacamole, and that's fine with me. I used to put out different types of soy cheeses. I don't do that anymore. It was in the old days. I was trying to, convert a lot of people thought I was converting a lot of people. And I don't do that anymore. One thing I do, though, is I use TVP, which is a textured vegetable protein, but I don't use the one that you can buy in the store. We don't believe that's a healthy type. of textured vegetable protein because it's manufactured, and the way they manufacture it is really not healthy. But I make my own TVP. And when you get your handout off our website, the last page will tell you, you can find out how to make tofu TVP in the May 2005 newsletter. And it tells you what to do with it, how to make it, how to make it, and how to use it in dishes. And it's really easy to make, and it's healthy. And so I will do that. Now, if I were making this meal for just John and myself, there would be beans, corn tortillas, some lettuce, some tomatoes, some onions, and that's probably all. Because we're happy with that. You know, we're happy with just having a couple of really simple bean burrito meals. If the grandkids are coming over, I said I have to bring out the guacamole. If the grandchildren are coming over, I have to make rice. If my son Craig is coming over, I also have to make rice because he likes rice on his burrito. John doesn't like rice on his burrito, so I never have to make rice if it's just John and myself. So you kind of can adjust the meal to whoever is going to be eating it with you. And that way you decide what you're going to make. And everybody makes their own burrito the way they want it, and everyone's happy. Now, these are things that we've been talking about that you already like. They're familiar foods. Potatoes and pasta and beans and rice. So I'm not asking you to find a whole lot of new things. Stick with the things that you already like. What we're going for is a satisfied palate, satisfied hunger, great health, full function, a trim body. And besides, you save money. And look at how much you can eat. We're not limiting your portion size. You can have as much as you want. Let's go on for a couple of minutes to talk about oil substitution. Now, when you cook without oil and you're going to be sauteing onions and mushrooms and things like that, you're going to saute in a pan like this, usually. So you put your onions and mushrooms in the pan, add a splash of water or vegetable broth, and stir them, and they get nice and brown and crispy without adding any oil to them. Very simple to do. You can use vegetable broth, you can use tomato juice, you can use a little soy sauce, you can use just plain water in almost every recipe that calls for oil. Because what they're using the oil for is they're going to tell you to put the oil in the pan, then add the onions and mushrooms, and you're going to be sauteing in oil. And you don't want to do that, so you substitute water or vegetable broth. Really simple. However, does not work so well if you're going to be baking, because you can't just take out the oil from those muffins you were making and substitute water for the oil, or you'll be left with hockey pucks. Because you won't be able to eat them. They'll be way too hard. You have to have a good fat replacer when you're baking. The best fat replacers that I have found are either made from prunes or from apples because of the pectin content. And so they actually make fat replacers, and that's what they have in them. is prunes and apples because of the pectin. You can also use flaxseed and tofu, but why do you think they work as a fat replacer? They have fat in them already. So basically, I never use those. I don't like the flavor of flaxseed added to things, and I don't like the texture. when I use tofu, but for prune puree or applesauce, things seem to turn out right. You'll have a chance to try some of our brownies in a couple of nights, and they are made with prune puree. Works really, really well. Let me tell you a secret. In most of my recipes, you will find that I call for this product right here, Wonder Slim Fat and Egg Substitute, or Fat Replacer. It's made from plums and apples and water. Well, about 5 years ago, they stopped making it. Just didn't have enough people that wanted to replace their fat, I guess. So then I told people, well, it's okay. Just go buy SunSweet Lighter Bake. It's the same product. It was a little harder to find, but you could buy it online. And it was made from plums and apples and water. Well, about 2 years ago, they stopped making that. Now, I can't go back and change all of my recipes and take those words out, but what I can do is to tell you how to make your own. And it's in the November 2008 newsletter, but I'm going to show you really fast how to do it. It's really simple. You take pitted plums, they're called plums these days. They don't call them prunes anymore, right? Pitted plums. Politically correct plums. Put them into the 1 cup line. Kind of push them down a little bit with your fingers. Don't scrunch them in there, but put them down. And then add warm water up to the 2 cup line. Now, it's not going to be exactly 1 cup of water because it's going to kind of go in through the holes of the prunes that are in there, or the plums that are in there. So it'll be a little bit more than 1 cup. But I want it to be up to the 1 cup line, and you let it sit here on the counter for 2 or 3 minutes, and then take the whole thing and dump it into your high-speed food processor or high-speed blender, and blend it until it is the consistency of applesauce, or it looks like this. And then you use it as a fat replacer. And in any recipe that it's used, you use half the amount of the oil called for. So for example, if you're making muffins and the muffin recipe says to add 1 cup of oil, you would add a half a cup of this fat replacer. So it's 1/2 to 1. And it works in cakes, it works in pies, it works in muffins, it works in almost anything that you can think of. And it doesn't taste like plums or prunes. For some reason, it doesn't work that way. But it makes a great fat replacer. There's also another product that came out probably 10 years ago that made me start making muffins again. Probably 15 years ago or so, you could buy muffin, nonstick, hard muffin tins. And that was before they started making the silicone muffin liners. You could only get the paper ones, and they didn't work. So I never made muffins until I found this stuff. And it's listed up here as magic plastic, but it's not plastic. It's made from silicone. And it looks like this. And the great thing about it is that it bends. So when you make muffins in something like this and you want your muffin to come out, you just go like this. And it just pops right out. And you just wash them with a brush. You never have to do anything to them. You put them in the oven just like this with nothing underneath them. And after cooking for, well, maybe 30 minutes or so, and if you can wait, you wait until you can touch this. My grandchildren will vouch for this. They'll wait. Can we touch it yet, Grandma? Can we touch it yet? As soon as you can touch it, then it's okay to do this. And so the same thing is true if you're going to use these. You see all the different ones I have. Loaf pans, cake pans. I have a flat one here. I have one to make brownies. Again, if you're going to use them, make sure that you pop the whole thing out. Even the flat brownie pan or the cake pan, invert it over a plate and then pop the whole thing out by the edges. Don't try to dig it out. It doesn't come out real well. So now, what you're looking for is something made from solid silicone. And what's really interesting to me is John just talked about, he didn't tell where we met, but he talked about meeting me. Well, where we met was in the operating room of an orthopedic surgeon who invented silicone joints. And he invented joints made out of this stuff that you would insert into the fingers of people that had really bad arthritis. And so I remember feeling this stuff. And every time I touch it now, it takes me back that many years to the operating room and thinking about putting silicone joints into people. So what you're looking for is a solid silicone material. Okay, this is medical grade silicone, not plastic with a silicone coating over it. So that's really important because that will eventually come loose. You want solid silicone. My favorite brand is the one up here called Silicone Zone. If you're looking for it, you can buy it on Amazon. Make sure you put it in as one word, Silicone Zone, just like this, no space in between. If you put it in as two words with a space in between, what you will get is advertisements for boob jobs. Promise. Now you're all gonna go try, right? For baking also, I find this to be very handy. It's an egg replacer. It doesn't make anything resembling scrambled eggs. It's a flour product, usually made from rice flour, potato flour, tapioca flour. It looks like cornstarch when you take it out of the box. I usually buy it in the box and pour it immediately into a glass container and I just store it in my pantry. One more thing for your pantry shelf. Very important. It tells you on the back how to use it. You can either mix it with warm water and whisk it until it becomes sort of frothy. It almost looks like egg whites. Or you can just put it in with the dry ingredients and then mix the wet and dry ingredients together and it'll work just as well. Baking powder. The reason the baking powder is here is because how many of you knew that there is aluminum in many baking powders? Okay, a lot of you people do, but many people do not. And we certainly do not need to eat aluminum. So buy a baking powder without aluminum. Look for it. It's listed in the ingredient list. Works the same. Not necessary at all. Rumford is one that, one brand. The reason I have it here is because it does not contain aluminum. You can find many low-fat vegan websites on the internet. These are a few that we have found that this is from the Healthiest Diet on the Planet book. You don't have to take a picture of this. If you go online to where all of these little goodies are, it will be there right along next to that. And there are many other ones that you can find yourself. Just search for low-fat vegan websites and you'll find many other ones. But these are some of our favorites that we have listed here. and you can get that online. Now, what I recommend and what this whole talk has mainly been about is for you to change as little as possible. Work with things that you already like. Choose the style of cuisine that you and your family already enjoy. If you like Mexican food, then look for Mexican dishes and make those so that your whole family can enjoy them. If you like Italian foods, then focus on that. Don't try to make it so different that people are going to say, wait a minute, what happened? I don't like this. But if they already like Mexican food or they already like Italian food and you can make it healthy for them, then they'll like it. What I recommend that you do is make a menu planner. Again, this is something you can find online. And find things that you like and list out what you like for breakfast, what you'd like for dinner, and then maybe go back up for lunch and you'll have lots of ideas of leftovers from your dinner. So these are just a few examples of different things that you can choose. For example, John told you about our oatmeal the other morning. I waited for him to say, remember he said I gave him the oatmeal with more sugar on it? He didn't tell you the rest of the story. As soon as I found out that I had given him that one and I ate his, I grabbed mine back from him. And I gave him the one with a little bit less sugar on it because I like mine with more sugar. So that's the rest of the story. I got the oatmeal that I like. So almost every morning for breakfast, we have oatmeal with blueberries. Kind of boring, but you know, it's pretty easy. And I'm usually looking for easy. Every once in a while, I'll surprise him. I'll say, oh, we're having hash browns this morning. He'll be happy about that. But he's happy with his oatmeal, with his little bit of sugar. We used to have parrots. Parrots. We had birds that lived in our house. We do not have them anymore. They are very messy. They're also very noisy. But we had a parrot. And he would eat our oatmeal with us. And he would never eat from John's bowl because John didn't have enough sugar on his oatmeal. He would only eat from my bowl. We'll see, a little bit of sugar. It's okay. You can choose many varieties. If oatmeal is too much work for you, and really, it's hardly any work at all. But you could go for cold cereal. All you have to do is open a box and pour it in a bowl and add a little non-dairy milk and maybe some fruit and you're set. I told you my parents never, or my mom never cooked much. They both lived into their 90s and they only ever ate cold cereal for breakfast. I never had hash browns for breakfast. We never had eggs for breakfast. I didn't know that people ate eggs for breakfast. We had eggs maybe once a month, and that was for dinner. You know, I was just shocked when I married John and I found out that he wanted eggs for breakfast. It was, oh, people eat eggs for breakfast? I had no idea. I thought cold cereal was it. But you can make pancakes, waffles, hash browns, all kinds of things that you could choose for breakfast to keep it really simple. And if you have these things available, then it'll be really easy for you. Just find one or two that you like. The next thing I would look at is dinner. I mentioned, you know, Italian foods, Mexican foods, Asian foods. Things that you are already familiar with. Find something that you like, keep it simple, and then have leftovers for lunch the next day. And yes, you can have dessert once in a while. We had dessert tonight. If you had your own chef, There you go. So make the effort into doing this. If you put the effort into it by making, by planning your meals using a menu planner, making a shopping list, remember to plan your meals around the starch. Keep it simple. I hope that what I have shared with you tonight has showed you that it can be very, very simple and yet very, very delicious and very filling. And if you keep your kitchen well stocked so that your pantry doesn't look like that empty white cupboard that woman was looking into, but it's filled with really healthy, delicious things that you can cook in a hurry, like I showed you tonight, then you'll be successful. And I want to finish with one thing. This is my dad. He's been gone about 10 years now, but he changed the way he ate when he was about 72. After many years of us sort of harping at him, he finally had a heart attack and decided, well, I guess I better change. And so he had another 20 great years after he changed the way he ate. And he used to come out, he and my mother used to come out to our house, because we lived in Hawaii then, and they lived in Michigan. And who would want to spend the winter in Michigan? If you could come and live with your son-in-law and your daughter in Hawaii. So they used to come out and stay with us for usually 2 months. And John would work with my dad. And my dad was really a great home remodeler. And he could do anything. You know, just whatever you wanted fixed, he would fix it. He was just like that. And John was much more particular about things. And so he and John would work together. And I can still hear my dad saying this to John. You know, John would be out there measuring everything, trying to get it perfect. And my dad would say, just nail it up there. You're not building a piano. And that's what I'd like to say to you, is just put the food out there. You're not building a piano. You just want to have some good, healthy food in front of you and some good, healthy food in your house to make it easy. And all the things that I shared with you today were easy and fast and filling and delicious. And anybody could do it. Anybody could do it. Even if you never learned how to cook when you were a kid. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mom. That was great. I use all of those tips all the time when I cook, every day. We have a few minutes for questions, if anyone wants to come up.
Hey, Mary, I've gotten into making pancakes lately.
Okay.
Do you premix the dry ingredients in a separate container, or do you
when
just...
When I'm making pancakes?
Yeah.
Do I premix the dry ingredients and the wet ingredients?
Like in a bit, no, a big batch of the dry ingredients.
Oh, do I like make a big batch of the dry ingredients? No, I don't, but that's a good idea.
Okay.
I make them one batch at a time, but I always mix my dry ingredients in a separate bowl and my wet ingredients in another bowl, and then I combine them briefly. But if you did make a big batch of your dry ingredients, you could store them in the cupboard, and then it would save a lot of time because you always have to mix your wet and dry together anyway. So that'd be great.
So did you tell them about your egg replacer trick, or what I taught you about egg replacer?
Well, I sort of alluded to it in
the
story.
So for years, she said you had to mix it, or that's what they say on the box, I think, still.
Yeah,
you have to mix it with warm water now and then add it to your wet ingredients. Well, I got tired of doing that, and I thought, why, it's a dry ingredient, why can't I just put it in with my dry ingredients? So I did, and it works great, and I've been doing it that way ever since.
I did kind of tell him that when I was talking about the egg replacer. I said, you can either mix it up or you can just dump it in with the dry ingredients. Remember, everyone? I did say that.
Yes.
But I didn't tell them. It was you that told me that. So that was Heather's brilliant idea, and so it saves a lot of time. And it works just as well.
Hello. Thank you so much for a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
So, sorry. Rooster sauce, and we have the organic mix. Can you share some of your other favorite and versatile spices that you love to use?
My other favorite sauces. Wow. I do use a lot of mustard. I think we use rooster sauce with almost every meal. It just adds something to it. And I don't know what. Other favorite sauces. I'm kind of picturing my refrigerator. We like Cholula a lot also. And I think we just like hot sauces. So I think you have to try different ones until you find your favorite. And that's about all I can say.
Sometime this weekend, can you let us know where on the McDougall website we can find the handout? I wasn't sure where to find it.
It's on the green sheet.
Okay.
On the very back.
Halfway down. It says recipes menu.
About halfway down? Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Hi, Mary.
Hi.
Wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
You mentioned the mashed potatoes, and you said you added some gravy. How do you make that gravy?
How do I make the gravy? Oh. You know, the gravy is something that I make so often that I can tell you exactly how to do it without even a recipe. I make a double batch here, so let's cut it down. 2 cups of vegetable broth. All right. About 2 tablespoons of soy sauce. One tablespoon of tahini, which is optional. You can leave it out if you don't want the fat from the tahini. And if you leave out the tahini, add a dash or two of onion powder to it. It just gives it a little bit more flavor. And then you add 1/4 cup of brown rice flour. And that's your thickener. And then to that, I usually add a squirt of sriracha, of course. And stir this all until it becomes thickened. And that's the gravy that we use all the time. And the nice thing is because it's brown rice flour, you can actually walk away from it. You don't have to sit there and stir it, and it won't clump. You can actually walk away and forget about it and come back, and you'll see that it's all boiling. And you just stir it, and there's no lumps. So I always make my gravy with brown rice flour. You're welcome.
Mary, stand up. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, does it work?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, as I say, I'm near 70, Mary's near 71. I wish you the same amount of enjoyment and health that we've had the opportunity to have. And believe me, I either wouldn't be standing here, Mary would be standing alone. And we certainly wouldn't look like we do and enjoy the things that we've enjoyed if we hadn't had this cosmic galactic collision 45 years ago.
And I learned how to cook, too.
And you learned how to cook. Thank you, Mary.
Thanks. Thank you, everyone.
So with that enjoyable evening, we're going to let you all have a nice night tonight. We're going to start bright and early with lab tests. For those of you who are interested in lab tests, if you haven't signed up, likely they'll accommodate you. You must not eat after 8 o'clock. And what time do they start, Tiffany or Heather?
6:30.
They start taking blood for those of you who are interested in your lab tests. Otherwise, we will be starting at, there'll be a room right next door.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we'll be starting with presentations at 8 o'clock. And we have a tremendous day planned for you tomorrow and Sunday. So relax, enjoy yourself, eat a lot of good food, and thank you very much for coming, and thank you for joining us worldwide on the internet. Good night, folks.